Hello, my name is Felix Wechsler.
Hello, I'm Rainer Heintzmann.
And today we talk about FourierTools.jl, which is a toolbox simplifying working with the frequency space. So FourierTools is a package basically built on FFTW. So we don't provide our own Fourier transform routine. So for that, we use the FFTW package. However, what we do, we provide several helper functions, which ease the way to work with the Fourier space. So especially like the shifting and also some boundary handling. And we implement a lot of algorithms based on the FFTs, for example, like image rotation, image interpolation, or shifting. Yeah. So again, what's the Fourier transform? So purely mathematically defined, a Fourier transform is a complex value sum, as you can see it here. So you can also decompose that into a sum with cosine and sine terms. And their inverse transform is very similar, especially there is some normalization factor and also different sign. However, the essence from that equation is that the Fourier transform decomposes a signal into harmonic basis function. So it's basically a series where you express a signal in a weighted sum of cosine terms and sine terms. And if you apply a Fourier transform, you basically go to a different basis or different space, and that we usually call the signal is represented in Fourier or frequency space. So Fourier and frequencies are synonyms to each other, mostly used. The naive sum calculation, if you would evaluate it, if evaluate the sum above, takes big O of n squared operations for 1D data set with n points. The FFT algorithms, the fast Fourier transfer algorithms, evaluate that in n log n operations. So it's much quicker, especially in 2D or 3D. There's a huge difference. And in Julia, there's this FFTW package available, which is commonly used.
So in this package, we provide several flavors of the standard FFTW routine. They differ in the way that they treat the zero coordinate. And so what you see here on the top is an example of a function that we want to Fourier transform. And as you see in the graph below it, the Fourier transform, if you just use the standard FFTW routine, actually has this the frequency, the zero frequency, not in the center of your result, but it has it at the zero coordinate on in the left hand side. And that means that the negative frequencies, which should appear on the negative side, actually appear on the right hand side because it counts backwards. And of course, FFTW provides routines to deal with that. So that's the routines called FFT shift. But we have packaged this into two convenience methods that allows you to work in an easier way with Fourier transforms. And that you see in the examples shown below. So the first such convenience method, what you see here is FFTS. So that means instead of writing FFT shift from FFT, you can simply write FFTS and it saves you a little bit of work. And it's done in a fairly efficient way so that that sometimes these shifts even cancel out when they can. Furthermore, there's now the different FFT methods. So there's the FFT, the standard FFT that we've discussed already. And in this example that you see at the top here, we've Fourier transformed a delta function positioned at the left-hand side of the array, which is indeed the zero coordinate as the FFT would ordinarily do. However, if we then put it in the middle, as you see, the FFTW routine does not give you any more a real constant one array, but it gives you complex factor. That's because the original delta function that we transform is not at the zero coordinate. If you, however, use instead the FT routine, so one F less, just Fourier transform in that sense, then it is already centered also in real space. So that means this FT routine uses the right-hand center of your array in real as well as in Fourier space. And there's also a routine called FFTS, as you've learned before, that does this only for Fourier space, but not for the real space.
So based on the FFT, we can also do some kind of sinc interpolation, because the FFT basically calculates the Fourier coefficients. So doing the FFT, you get the Fourier coefficients. And if you have the Fourier coefficients, you can evaluate the Fourier series. So you basically have the coefficients. And yeah, if you do an inverse transform, the inverse transform is essentially a re-evaluation of a Fourier series. And if we now pet our signal into, or if we pet them with zeros, what we effectively do, we re-evaluate this Fourier series, but at more sample points. So we don't add more information into the system. We just evaluate this analytical Fourier series at more sample points. So what we can see here in this plot is that the blue dots, they are a low sampling. So you can see it's quite coarse. However, if we go to Fourier space, zero pad that and do an inverse Fourier transform, you can see that the signal looks much nicer. So you would say, oh, there's much more information. It looks much nicer. However, it's the same information, just sinc interpolated, just it looks nicer. This sinc interpolation also works for images. So for example, on the left-hand side, you see the normal image. And then on the right-hand side, we can do a resampling where we just increase the second dimension with 712 samples. So we stretch it along. So there is no new information in this image. It's just a re-evaluation of the Fourier series. We also implemented the Fourier shift theorem. So you know, or we know that if you do a Fourier transform of a signal shifted, of a shifted signal, you see that it's just, there's just a phase factor added to the right-hand side. And doing the inverse transform, we can basically achieve a shifting by multiplying a phase factor to a signal. So we can see here that we can shift the signal, and notably we can do a sub-pixel shifting. So there, we can shift in any amount. If we also can do shifting, you know, there's this called free shear rotation algorithm. So if you can do shifting, you can do shearing. And if you can do shearing, you can do rotation. So based on the FFT, we implemented also an image rotation algorithm.
And of course, FFTs are used a lot also for convolution. And here you see a nice example how simple it is to convolve with the toolbox. So the size of the convolution kernel is varied here. It's a Gaussian kernel, and you see how the details in the image change via this convolution. All of these routines are implemented fairly efficiently, and most importantly, the efficient implementation also includes that we handle the boundary conditions correctly. So when Felix just said you are putting zeros on the side, it turns out that this is not precisely correct, and you have to handle the borders, especially for even-sized array coordinates, a little bit differently. And this is all taken care of in this package. So FourierTools provides convenient wrappers, and it offers efficient algorithms like sinc interpolation, and it handles the boundary. So thank you very much for listening.